Hi, hello, namaste. In this section, I'll be introducing you to magnetostatics field. Basically, in our previous lectures or in the classroom teaching, we had come across electrostatic fields, and it was characterized by the things like electric field intensity, electric flux density, and we have also come across laws like Coulomb's law, which defines the forces between charges, as well as from the Coulomb's law I got the field intensity at a given point in space. And later on we also characterized the other form of Coulomb's law, that is the Gauss law, wherein the Gauss law stated that if I know the amount of flux that is getting diverged out, then I know what is the amount of charges that is present inside a volume. So if you remember all these things, these were all the things which was related to electrostatics. Okay, so there was a definite link between this electric and magnetic fields, which was actually established by Oersted in 1820s, somewhere around there. So what he actually noticed was, when a charge wasn't stationary, you know, you have an electric field around it. Okay, say for example, I have a charge Q. So around this charge Q, there will be an electric field which is stationary. Stationary means to say, so I'll call this as electric field. Electric field. So it was stationary electric field, and hence the study of this type of fields was called as electrostatics. But when I made this charge to move, okay, so now the charge is in motion. Okay, the charge is in motion. So when I make the charge to move with some constant velocity, what he observed was, he actually saw a static magnetic field. So a static magnetic field was created across the motion of the charge. Wherever the charge moved across that path, there was a constant magnetic field, or a static magnetic field. You can think of a static magnetic field. Okay, so this produced a constant, like a this actually concluded in this way, that whenever there is a flow of charge, or whenever you say charge is being moving, then it constitutes nothing but current, electrical current. So whenever there is a constant current flow, there will be a magnetostatic field that is produced by this. Okay, that's what he concluded. So whenever there is a constant current flow, then there is a magnetostatic field. So a magnetostatic field will be generated. Okay, a magnetostatic field will be produced whenever there is a flow of current, that too a constant current. Okay, so this made him to explore more and more in terms of the studies with related to magnetostatics. And later in some time, the two scientists, which we have a law called Biot-Savart's law. So they were two scientists who defined or who made more exploration in terms of this magnetic field and the behavior of it. So to explain the Biot-Savart's law, what I have taken here is, I have taken a red conductor. You can see a red conductor over here. Okay, so this red conductor is carrying some constant current within it. Okay, some constant current flows. So I have put a dashed line. This dashed line, I wanted to speak with respect to two scenarios. Scenario 1 and 2. So say for example, I have a constant current of some I milliamp is flowing, or I amps is flowing, or some current of I is flowing. Let us keep it generalized. Some current I is flowing within the conductor. So as we said in our earlier introduction, when there is a flow of current, there is a static magnetic field that is generated across the conductor in a circular manner or a curly manner, okay, in the manner of this rotational force. Whatever I have represented here, this is a magnetic field lines. What they got to know was, like, as and when if I increase the current flow, so here it was say some lesser current, here the current is more, so if I increase the intensity of current, means I am bombarding more charges into the conductor, so the field strength also increased. The field strength, I am speaking about the magnetic field strength, okay, the magnetic field strength also increased. So there is one more thing that you can see here, and it was very much stronger at the core, or very much, if I'm calculating the field intensity near to the conductor, the intensity is too high. As I go away from the conductor, the intensity dropped, okay. So what this Bert Savart's Bio Savart's said was, like, they both were experimenting on this. They tried to relate this to our basic electrostatics expressions, okay, that is the Coulomb's law and the Ampere's circuit law was based on actually my So as I go away from the conductor, the intensity of magnetic field strength decreased. So what they concluded was, they here, means to say, the Bio Savart's, both the scientists, they concluded that there is a sort of relation between my electrostatics and a magnetostatics, and this effect is somewhere related to my electric field intensity. If you see, electric field intensity was also degrading as you go away from the charge. Similarly here, if I have a conductor, if I have a flow of current within the conductor, then there is a magnetic field around it. And as I go away from the conductor, the field strength decreased. So this is what they understood, and they went deep into this. One more thing was, in what direction this magnetic field is been revolving around my conductor. So to know this, I have just taken a snap of mine, and you can consider that the stylus I am holding is a conductor, okay, and the current that is flowing, I have wrapped that particular conductor in my right hand, okay. So my thumb finger represent the flow of current, or the direction of current, that is nothing but this within the conductor. Hence, my fingers, the other fingers other than the thumb, will represent the curl or the magnetic field lines that is rotational around that particular conductor. Okay, this is right hand magnetic flux lines rule, where you can see, or where you can understand, or where you can visualize how is my field lines being being rotated or being revolving around a conductor with respect to my flow of current. So if you see this particular, and if I want to represent that over here, you can say that these lines, okay, this lines has a magnetic field something like this. So the rotation of magnetic field, this again something like this. Since my current is moving in from bottom to top, the rotational force will be in from left to right. So if I say this is my screen, and I'm interested in speaking about this part, okay, I'm interested in seeing the magnetic flux at this part, okay, at this part, so I'll be zooming that particular part. So if I see that my magnetic flux lines are going within the screen, okay, it is revolving and it is going into the screen. If I say it is going into the screen, then I can represent that with this notation, Okay, so near to the conductor, more magnetic field. As I go away, the magnetic field strength decreases. Why should I write this? As I already said in the previous classes, if I take a vector will be having an arrowhead and it will be having an arrow tail, right? So if you see the vector from the behind, it looks like a crosshair. Whereas if you see from the front, it will be just looking like a dot, a point. So similarly, if I take this part and if I zoom this particular part out, okay, I'm now zooming this part. So if I see from that part, my vector which is coming, or the magnetic field lines will be coming out of the screen, if you are seeing that. So it should be represented like this. And as I go away from the conductor, so conductor will be here. As I go away from the conductor, the intensity decreases, hence I am seeing a smaller points as I go away. So this is what the concept of this magnetic field lines across a conductor. So what this Bio Savart's law states is, basically they took a conductor, okay, I'll now take a conductor over here. So I'll just consider a conductor. Some conductor is being considered, and what I am doing is, in this conductor I am trying to pass some current. So the current will be called as current I is being passed, and when I pass this current, I want to calculate what is the magnetic field intensity. So magnetic field intensity at this point P is defined as H. Okay, magnetic field intensity is always defined with H. I want to find H at this point, magnetic field intensity at this point, due to the current which is flowing in this conductor. So what I do now is, to calculate that, I'll be taking a small incremental length of a conductor, which I call it as DL, which we have already done. So I'll be taking a small incremental length of conductor DL, okay, within this small incremental length a current will be flowing. Because of this decremental length, what is the decremental magnetic flux? Okay, since I'm taking only a small part, this small part should affect this point P with a small magnetic field intensity, or a small magnetic field should be produced there. That's why I'll be taking it as DH. Okay, so to calculate that, first what I do is, I take a midpoint of this decremental length of a conductor and I'll draw a line to know the distance between this point and this midpoint. So it is at a distance R. Let us consider this at a distance R, and it is making an angle alpha with my conductor. Okay, so now to calculate the magnetic flux density at that point P, what I do now is, what basically Bio Savart explained was, the magnetic flux at that point DH, it is an incremental magnetic flux at that point DH, is proportional to the current that is flowing within this incremental length. The current that is flowing within that incremental length. So the current that is flowing in that incremental length DL. Okay, first one was that. Second proportionality thing was, the magnetic flux at this point P is always proportional to the sine of the angle, alpha, which is made by my distance vector to that of the length, decremental length. The third point was, DH, or the incremental or differential magnetic field, is proportional to the inverse square of the distance of separation. So it is proportional to the inverse square of the difference of separation. So if I sum up all this equation together, my magnetic field intensity at that point is proportional to I DL sine alpha divided by r square. Okay, so this is the thing that Bio Savart found out, and to remove that proportionality constant, I'll be substituting a factor k, which will be explained now. So magnetic flux at that point is equal to k into idl sine alpha, where k was defined as 1/4 pi. So this expression is almost getting equivalent to my Coulomb's law. So seeing that particular part, what I can write this expression as is dh is equal to idl sine alpha divided by 4 pi r square. Okay, so this equation, whatever we have discussed, is just the magnitude. Okay, it is just the magnitude of my magnetic field intensity at that point P. Okay, so if you see this particular current element, it is being, if I try to join this, this is my distance vectors, I mean distance of separation, so it can represent with a unit vector over here. So I'll be trying to represent that unit vector by r cap. Okay, and if you see this particular thing, the equation which you have written, I'll call this as equation A. If you try to understand this equation A now, equation A can be defined in terms of cross product of two vectors. Okay, this is just a magnitude. If I want to explain you with respect to the direction, then I can consider two vectors over here. One vector that corresponds to my differential length, dl vector. The other vector is the distance of separation between these two points, right? So if I say that, equation A can now be simplified and written in terms of vector as the vector dh is equal to idl cross the unit vector r cap divided by 4 pi r square. So where dl is the vector of the incremental length and r cap is a vector of the distance of separation between the points of the point where I'm finding the magnetic field intensity and the point where the differential element is considered. Okay, or else, you know, what is a unit vector being represented? Usually a unit vector can be represented by the vector r divided by the magnitude of that vector r, right? So distance of separation between the two points can be defined by this vector r, and its magnitude is r. If I simplify that in this particular expression, my final expression becomes dh is equal to idl cross, now the r cap can be written as the vector r divided by 4 pi r square is already there, and again you are multiplying that with another magnitude r, so this is again a r magnitude, that becomes r cube. So this is the equation for the magnetic flux, I mean the magnetic field intensity at that point P due to the current element dl. Okay, so due to this current element dl, I can find the magnetic field intensity at P. So if you see this expression is almost relative to my Coulomb's law, hence there is a relation between the Coulomb's law and my Bio-Savart's law. Okay, so this is how I define the magnetic field intensity, and I can also define the magnetic field directions by considering here, if I consider my right hand rule, so the current is moving in this direction, hence my field across this can be written or represented in this fashion. So it is flowing like this, the field lines are flowing like this, and you can also see if I'm like, if I see this expression, if I see this expression, can you visualize, like, if the conductor is like this at this angle? So this is, say the angle is 90 degree, at this angle the intensity will be maximum, right? Because of this current element, if I'm calculating, if I consider this as a current element at this point, let us say I'm getting some maximum magnetic field intensity, but as I go away from this, or as I go away from this, the angle becomes low and low, hence the magnetic field becomes low and low. So because of this current element, if I find the intensity here, field intensity here, the angle is almost zero, so you know sine of zero is zero. So that is one more understanding that I want you people to visualize. The second one is, as you are near, the flux is more. As you go more away, the flux reduces. By what? It reduces by r square term, but in the final expression it reduces by r cube times. So as you go more away and away, it is inversely proportional to the cube root of that particular distance. So these are the inferences that I wanted to make in this particular part of Bio Savart's law. Bio Savart's law states that the differential magnetic field intensity dH produced at the point P due to the differential current element IdL is proportional to the product of I times dL and the sine of the angle alpha between the element and the line joining the point P, and is inversely proportional to the square of the distance between the point P and the element. So hope this is understood. If you have any doubts or queries, please do let me know. I'll help you out. Thank you.